Good morning, friends.
I'm honored to be here. You know, you should be very proud of the fact that you are in IT academics, because I did my MBA from FMS in 1983, and I had the privilege, you know, that my family could afford foreign travel in 70s and 80s. When we would go to a foreign country, you know, Indians were very looked down upon. For example, if you were in Europe, you would want to enter a jewelry store, they won't open the door for you. We used to face the same thing in Hong Kong. The only country which sort of respected Indians to some extent was Russia. Everywhere else we were, you know, considered to be a country of snake charmers, etc. This image of India has changed because of the IT professional. And I think we should all cheer to that at least in one vertical, this country has reached global standards. So you are very privileged that you are going to be IT professionals, something which India is so proud of. I will not be esoteric. I'll try to be very, you know, simple and tell you some hard facts, I think, which you should all know. And the idea is to, in a way, to try and inspire you and also tell you what are the infirmities of our system and, you know, where it has landed us. While I said that, you know, the IT professional has done so well, when you visit San Francisco, the Bay Area, and you enter a restaurant, you know, it seems you are in Bangalore or Delhi, you know, and there are restaurants where you'll just hear Telugu language being spoken, and so it's very uplifting. But let me give you some very hard facts. India's per capita income was more than China in 1990, I think before most of you were born. And it was in fact more than even Korea and you know, other Far East countries. Today, India's per capita income is 1/5 of China. So in these 28 years, while China started growing like this, India's growth was like this. So something's gone wrong, that in every industry, in every trade, barring probably IT, we have been sort of left behind. And 1/5 is a very stark thing, you know. Something happening in 28 years is a very stark thing. And so who's responsible for it? I think all of us are responsible for this. And I feel particularly, you know, very responsible, because this has happened in my generation. When, you know, we were in the work age, this is what has happened. So I contemplate, you know, I sort of agonize about it, and then my mind goes back to 1990, when I actually visited China for the first time. And I was telling your principal director and the chairman that, so I decided to go to a factory and to a primary school. And when I went to the factory, it was about 10:45. Chinese eat very early, so their lunch is around 11, 11:30. Their breakfast is at 7, and, you know, their dinner is at 5:30. These are the work hours. This is how they eat. So when I asked them what is their, how happy they are, and, you know, what is their desire, in the factory, everybody was very happy, and they had no aspiration. There was no turnover. They were very happy with life. And in the primary school, every child gave me a different aspiration. A girl said, I want to be a doctor. So there was another gentleman, small. These were all kids 8, 9, 10 years old. And they all said basketball players. Somebody wanted to be an engineer. But when I said, what is your greatest desire? Every child said the same thing in different ways, that we want China to be the most powerful nation in the world. I think that was the one, you know, differentiating factor, that it was imbibed in the children that you have to take this country forward. And the great leader Deng Xiaoping, when he opened China, this was 78, 79. So in 1990, I just saw the beginning of the growth. It was still a very poor country, but we saw the beginning of the growth. So his 5-point program, which was rural enterprises, you know, opening the country to the world and making China the global manufacturing hub, were the few things which he did which made China such a powerful economy. This is almost a $12 trillion economy compared to $2.8 trillion. So I think there is a great responsibility which we have towards changing this whole thing and taking India to a different trajectory. The Prime Minister had called us about, in fact, last week, a group of 14 people, mostly from the digital industry, from IT services, from BPO services, from software, from electronic manufacturing. And his basic thought was that, you know, let's call it the digital industry. I think that's broadly what it is, because it's very difficult to call it information technology only now, because it's become more of a digital industry. So the Prime Minister felt that the digital industry, you know, permeates every part of trade, industry, human life, personal life, you know, family life. And so the responsibility on the digital industry is far greater, and it can take India to a different trajectory. And he gave a beautiful example, which was not esoteric. His communication is very basic, but very strong, fundamentally strong. He gave the example of Surat. He said, Surat is a big economy. There is so much diamond polishing there. But he says, is that enough? Is diamond polishing enough? India should aspire to design jewelry and to be the world leader in jewelry and not only in polishing. So the basic message was that, you know, we are very proud of the IT industry, that we've been able to do so much, processing and so on. We're working for others. And I think Indian companies like Wipro, Infosys, TCS are highly respected because they are very ethical companies. They do very complex projects for global companies, very, very complex projects, but nobody's ever heard that a design of a supercomputer has been leaked out or anything like that has happened. These companies do amazing, very high-tech work, but they are very ethical companies, very ethical companies. And I'll speak a bit about ethics and spirituality since we are so inspired by Swami Vivekananda. So the message which the Prime Minister gave and which we firmly believe in is that we must move up the value chain. That is very important. And that innovation will have to come from people like you, because you see, the large corporations are straitjacketed. Imagine a TCS or a Infosys or a Wipro, which already has massive contracts with global giants. So for them to compete by making their own products with their customers is not ethical. Wo kehte hai na, dono haath mein laddu nahi hote. So if you are in the contracting business, can you be in the business of creating products? It's a difficult one. So the disruptor is going to be innovators like you guys. There was a mention of electronic manufacturing here. So let me inspire you a little about what India has been able to achieve. In November, in 2014-15, we had just two factories of mobile phones in the country. And we were producing about 58 million mobile phones. The global market is about 2 billion phones. So 2,000 million phones are made in the world. And we were producing 58 million. Now this year, we will be manufacturing 290 million phones, and which is a value of 1,65,000 crores. And between mobile phones and components, we have 268 plants. So this is what has happened now. Now what about the value add? the objective was to build a massive world-class industry, and we are not happy with 290 million. The next target is 500 million, and the target after that is 1 billion phones. The Prime Minister announced in June that India will be the number one mobile phone manufacturing country in the world. Now look at that, look at the vision and the audaciousness of that statement. Because although we are now number two in the world, but we are 12% of the world's manufacturing. And China is 75%. And the Prime Minister, that's why, you know, sometimes people say ki ye inka jumla hota and so on. But he sincerely believes in it that India will go up to become number one, so which means that China will have to go down because China can't stay at 75%. If we have to, we suppose we capture 50%, so China will have to be at 40%, and you know there will be other countries. Vietnam is still 10%. So the whole, there will be countries like Indonesia, etc., which will also start producing. Can this happen? Can such an audacious thing happen? And then I'll tell you the big opportunities which for people like you, because obviously you are not going to be in factories producing phones. Those will be people, you know, rural girls and boys who have just done 10th class or 12th class, they will be producing phones and there'll be millions of jobs added at that level. But I'll come later to, you know, what is in it for you? So this kind of a churn, why is it going to happen? You see, there are, as Swami Vivekananda also said, there are cosmic forces, you know. Now, 1990, I told you the story of the factory I went to. Now, when you go to a Chinese factory, you find them restless, you know. In 1990, if a Chinese worker was earning 10,000 rupees, he was sending 9,000 rupees back to his family because food was free, stay was free. Today, it's very different. Today, the turnover, I was telling your project principal director that when I asked them what is the turnover of people, which means how many people are leaving every year, they didn't understand it because nobody ever left. You know, after the factory had been set, only one person had left that factory and there were 25,000 workers in that factory. So just imagine, in 4 years, only one person had left. Today, when I asked, I don't want to name the company, but it's the largest company in the world in manufacturing. I said, what is your turnover? He said, 8%. I said, that's very high. He said, no, it's 8% per month. Okay? So, what does it tell you? And they are restless because they have become wealthy. You know, their incomes are 5 times our incomes. The average worker there is earning about 60,000, 70,000 rupees equivalent. And a lot of workers there go and buy an iPhone. They have become very self-centered. The whole system has changed because they become wealthy. So how manufacturing moved from Europe to United States, because United States had the big market, big population, big number of workers, and then it moved to Japan. Japan was a small country. It didn't have that much manpower. So it quickly moved to Korea, Taiwan, and also moved to the Far East, and then to China. Now, China is a giant country, so manufacturing has stayed there. You know, it's a massive manufacturing economy. So this is India's opportunity, because in this journey, what we've seen in the last 4 years, what I told you, how mobile manufacturing has become so big in India, although it is still about 12% of the world, how it has become so big. There is a myth that Indians don't produce good quality and they are not productive. This is not true. In the first 2-3 months when our mobile phone manufacturing factories were being set up, you know, our productivity was very low. But within 3 months to 6 months, the productivity became on par with China. Today, we are beating China on every parameter of productivity. And I'm talking about core manufacturing. You all know that in IT services, in software, in coding, Indians are par excellence. But I'm telling you about core manufacturing, right? on the same line where we are producing 2,000 phones, smartphones in China, the Indian equivalent plants are producing 2,500 to 26 with the same workforce. So Indians are more productive. The theory which we say is that, you know, we have PhDs, poor, hungry, and desirous people. That hunger is converting into productivity. And we are finding that. So I think this big thrust of manufacturing in electronics is going to happen here, right? And I'll encourage you all to read a document called the National Policy on Electronics 2019, which is, you know, I'm going to keep talking about electronics because I want your focus to move away a little bit from outsourcing jobs and so on, that, you know, this is a big thing which is happening now. The National Policy on Electronics has a vision. Obviously, the Prime Minister said that you should be number one in mobile phone manufacturing. So that's one strong vision, which is that our manufacturing target, I just told you a very impressive figure of 1,65,000 crores is what we are going to produce this year. The target for 2025 is about 13 lakh crores, and most of them is exported. When my introduction was being given, you know, I felt a little upset because it talked about import substitution. We are no longer talking about import substitution. We are a very confident manufacturing country now. We are a very confident nation because we've seen the productivity gains. Because we are more productive, and all the ecosystems in the world are coming here, we are now talking about exports of $110 billion. That's about 7.5-8 lakh crores of exports of mobile phones from India, which is the most cutting edge electronic product in the world, right? So has India arrived in electronic manufacturing? Yes, it has. Is value addition enough? No, it is not. Is there sufficient amount of R&D and design being done? No, it is not. So now I come to your opportunity. When this $400 billion worth of electronics is going to be produced, which is now happening, and with the trend which has started in mobile phones, we will create a lot of testing jobs, we'll create a lot of design jobs, right? And design in mobile phones is not only what you do on AutoCAD. That is, you know, so there are four or five designs when you do a mobile phone. A mobile phone has approximately 38 technologies and sciences in it. You know, there is electrical because you have a charger. Of course, you know, there is a lot of electronics in it. There is a lot of software engineering in it. So everything you will think of, there is a lot of electrochemistry in it and so on. So the design element will be, of course, there's going to be a lot of software engineering in the smartphone. I think the greatest event in this century was on 29th June 2007, when the iPhone was launched. I think that has changed our life completely. And quickly after that, Android followed. By the end of 2007, 2008, we had beta versions of Android. So in these 10 years, our life has completely changed. Every part of business, trade, personal life is a part of that. And, you know, we used to communicate as children to pen friends in Korea and Finland and US. Now, you know, with Facebook and social media stuff, imagine how empowered life has become. So, but coming back to design, I think software design, which is a part of the mobile phone design, and industrial design, mechanical design, and electronic design. None of you are electronic engineers, but the software engineering of the mobile phone and the application development is a very, very big area which India is now going to promote, right? I'll just give you a number, it'll startle you. Just iPhone, the iStore, paid $17 billion to developers in China in the last 4 years. This is the amount of money which goes in app development. So software engineering, which is for the mobile industry, our estimate is that as we are going up the value curve and the design starts in India, you know, a lot of global companies like Samsung and others have design in India, R&D in India, but they are not controlling the entire product. And when I went to the Samsung headquarters in Korea, guess which was the cuisine which I enjoyed the most? Indian. There's an Indian restaurant in the Samsung headquarters because there are 500 software engineers creating the most cutting edge smartphones in the world. They have a center in Bangalore, which has about 10,000 people, and Noida, and they have a the project managers are all in Korea. These 500, the elite force of these guys. Absolutely exhilarating when you see that happening, you know. And when you see the Koreans enjoying the Indian food, it's even more encouraging. So this industry, the design industry, both software and application development, is a very, very lucrative industry for people like you in the next 5 years. So please look beyond IT services, please look beyond software and look at this. And it's also a bit easier and a bit more creative. You know, if you're developing applications, if you're, of course, software engineering for mobile phone is extremely technical and it requires, you know, similar skills. And India is very, very strong in that. Now, I told you I'll be talking a bit about ethics and so on. You know, when we look at employees, human beings have normally four bodies, you know, the physical body, the mental body, the spiritual body, and the intellectual body. So when we look at people, I think these four have to be very well balanced. And I think we have been sort of receding in our spiritual wealth as a nation, as institutions, as corporates. And when you benchmark with the US, which is the largest economy in the world with $17 trillion of GDP, you see that the spiritual content, the charitable content in that country, in the corporates and in people, is far more. I think that's the one reason why, you know, everything is very straightforward and not convoluted. So I'd like to leave that thought with you. The other thought, which, you know, when we are doing this self-analysis, you know, we are doing a lot of self-analysis these days. Some of them initiated by the Prime Minister, because he's very restless. He said one thing, you know, he was in the middle of elections and he found time to meet. This was his own initiative. And he said, my second term, I am going to begin first day ground running. You know, last time I didn't have enough ideas because, you know, and I don't want to waste that time. So please give me inputs and ideas. And I'll encourage you all, if you have any ideas, my email ID is available here. And so please send it to us so that we can, anything which comes to your mind, which is innovative, cutting edge, please do let us know for nation building. The last thing which I wanted to leave a thought with you was this introspection thinking which we are doing. Why we are a weak economy, you know, why we are one-fifth of China, or so one analysis we found was that all the major economies, a very large portion of that economy is big champion companies. So if you look at the US, 60-65% of their economy is big champion companies. And I don't have to mention the US companies to you. In the Fortune 500, you know, they would be having probably 250, 500 companies. Do you know how many Indian companies are in the Fortune 500? Any idea? I think we have 6 or 7 or probably 9 companies, which is, I think, a very big weakness. So our large corporations are a very small portion of our economy. In Korea, it is probably 75% is the large corporations. So For India to become a leading economy of the world, we'll have to build big companies. And we'll have to build Indian champion companies also. When I told you about this movement of electronic manufacturing from US to Japan, to Korea, to Taiwan, and then to China, if you remember, maybe you would have read about it, you won't remember, of course, is that a lot of manufacturing had moved to Philippines, Malaysia, Thailand also. But these countries never became big economies because they never had domestic champion companies, which Japan, Korea, and Taiwan, and now China have built very big, massive companies. So for India to become a glorious, large economy, I think that's a very important thing. As I started my talk to you, as I said, I will not be esoteric. I'll keep it very, you know, basic and very human. And I'm available if there are any questions in your mind. I'll love to field them and to interact with you. Thank you very much.